From Boston to Vegas to Beijing and Broadway, we are going global today here on Off Duty. But first, I'm out here in left field in historic Fenway Park, home to the Boston Red Sox, and celebrating its 100-year anniversary. We will be coming to you from the entire show here. But first up, we want to show you how they get those cool striping patterns that you see on the field on TV and how you can make your own home look like the major leagues. Welcome to Off Duty. We are here in historic Fenway Park. It is the home to the Boston Red Sox. It is also the oldest baseball park in America. And we are standing next to the guy who is lucky enough to come to work here every day, Dave Miller. He is the director of grounds. What's a better job than this?
There isn't one. This is just the best.
And you are the guy, basically, who is the godfather of striping. And that is the phenomenon that we all see, the patterns on the field. How different is striping from stadium to stadium?
Well, patterns are only limited by your imagination. Certainly at this level, safety and playability is our first priority. But whether it's a traditional checkerboard or something festive like the Sox logo, it's about having fun too.
And it's not something you can just have to have professional equipment to do. Homeowners can do it too, and you're gonna teach us that a little bit later in the show. But for people who don't actually know what striping is and how it happens, you're not coloring the grass, you're bending the grass.
Correct. A light stripe's mowed away from you, in a dark stripes mode toward you. You think of velvet or velour, if you run your fingers against it, you're changing the nap of the grass. And so it's just about mowing in a certain direction that reflects that light differently on the grass.
Now, this is mostly for the enjoyment of the people in the stands or the people watching on TV, because you can't see it as much when you're on the field, is that right? And it certainly doesn't affect play.
Correct, that's the goal, for it not to affect play, but certainly on TV or higher up, you certainly see the patterns more then.
Sounds just like it does on TV. Now, some people put all these fancy degrees on their walls. I think you've done better. This is your artwork. These are all fields you've striped?
Well, I'm fortunate to have a great staff, but yeah, this is kind of a collaboration of artwork we've done on fields throughout the year.
Tell us about a few of them.
Well, this is a tartan plaid that came as an inspiration from an Argyle sweater I saw. When Bruce Springsteen was here, we actually wrote Bruce on the infield and made the B a Red Sox B.
Is he a Red Sox fan?
Well, I think he was that day.
He was that day. What happens if you make a mistake?
You know, it's very easy to fix. If you make a mistake, it's nothing to worry about. Just go back to the previous line before and start over.
That's it. Just roll it the other way.
It's absolutely. You just start with that fresh edge and you just start right over. Let's walk over and check out the Toro Triplex reel mower. It has three cutting units on it, two in the front and one underneath the seat. And they're reel mowers, very much like the old-time push mowers you would see your father's using. And there's a roller in the front that helps stand up the grass with these grooves. The units then cut behind it, and behind the cutting unit is a roller that helps bend in that design.
And the roller is what basically makes the striping pattern, because it's flattening the blades one way or the other, and the light reflects off of that.
Absolutely. Any mower will make a pattern in the grass with its tires and its blade, but the rollers really help etch in that design.
65,000 square feet of Kentucky bluegrass here in the outfield. That's about how big, an acreage?
About an acre and a half.
Acre and a half. So many homeowners might have that, and if they want to try this themselves, is this one of the machines they would use to do it?
This is the perfect machine for them. It's a Simplicity lawn and garden tractor, and the back of the deck has rollers on it, so it follows any contours in your lawn, so it can't scalp. But what's great about it also is those rollers are just like the rollers on the expensive equipment here, and they're going to put a pattern in your lawn while you mow.
And how short are you cutting the grass here, and how short should homeowners cut it? Because it's different.
That's a great question. We're mowing at 1.25 inches here. Homeowners should be mowing between 2.5 and 3.5 inches, because that extra grass blade is going to shade the roots so it doesn't dry out as quickly. And, you know, they don't have to worry about playability issues. So I would encourage them to mow high and mow often, so they're following what's called the 1/3 rule. they're never cutting off more than one third at a time, so they're not out there baling hay, basically, in their yard.
You mentioned a lot of these tips in your book. It's what? Picture-perfect mowing techniques for lawns, landscapes, and sports. It's all in here. Patterns, tips, all of that.
Absolutely. Turf 101, but if you want to mow like the majors, the information's right there. Step-by-step instructions. And in fact, it teaches you how to make your own roller at home. If you go to a lawnmower repair shop, they're going to have a graveyard of mowers behind the store that they have lawnmower handles on. And then we just take PVC pipe, and you can cut it to whatever length you want, and we fill it with concrete. We make end caps out of plywood to hold it in there, find the center point, put your bolt on, and then you can just connect it. That's gonna help put that pattern in your lawn and add to that curbside appeal.
And now the one thing I've always wondered too is, how do you keep your lines so straight? I mean, I've always imagined you're out here with like string or whatever, or somebody on the sidelines, but it doesn't seem like that's the case.
Well, certainly if we're doing a unique pattern like the Sox logo, we'll measure that out. But otherwise, a homeowner can use the side of the driveway or pick a point in the distance, like a window, a tree, a shrub, and mow toward it. That's what we do. We'll pick a point on the wall pad or on the track and mow toward it.
Well, lucky for us, the Sox are on the road right now. They don't mind if we play around with the patterns a little bit, do they?
I don't think so. I think, in fact, you can help.
I can help. Moment of truth, striping the oldest ballpark in America. Hope I don't mess up.
Oh, have fun.
All right. We're back here behind the legendary Green Monster Wall, and this is where Boston still scores their games manually by hand. These plates, they are almost relics. We're going to pop one out here in just a second, but first we want to check in with Jeff Bush as he goes to Sin City to check out some relics of his own, neon signs in a graveyard where they go to die. While he does that, I'm going to put the socks up by two. Bobby's not here, so I'll make the call.
Las Vegas. I have to admit, it's never been one of my favorite destinations. I have nothing against the city itself, but it's just that not being much of a drinker or a gambler, and not really interested in what passes for modern variety entertainment, there just never seemed to be very much for me there. Maybe if I'd been born in a different time, a different era, I might have liked seeing the Rat Pack perform during their brief historic prime. Seeing the likes of Dino, Sammy, and Frank, it might have been different. I mean, those guys owned this town. Maybe my time, like theirs, has passed. Maybe it's time for me to hit the Boneyard. I met up with Las Vegas historian Bill Marion for a behind-the-scenes look at the Neon Boneyard, a final resting place. A sort of cemetery, if you will, for some of the city's most iconic signs. He is the chairman of the board of the soon-to-open Neon Museum, which will showcase these signs. He explained how neon signs defined the history of Sin City.
Well, this sign was designed by Betty Willis, who is the same designer who created the Welcome to Las Vegas sign, which may be one of the most famous signs in the world. In 1955, the Moulin Rouge was built, and it was the first integrated hotel casino in Las Vegas, in the West Las Vegas area. The funny story about it is it operated as a casino and resort for only about 8 months. Whenever the lounge shows on the Strip would close up around 2 o'clock, the performers would head over to the Moulin Rouge and do jam sessions. Well, all the gamblers came with them. Mm-hmm. So there's some speculation that maybe a little shady mob action going on there.
Yeah.
The governor convened the business owners, hotel owners, and minority leaders together at the Moulin Rouge, and they hammered out what is now known as the Moulin Rouge Accord. And on that day, Las Vegas was desegregated. The sign is all that's left.
Over the years, technology, as it tends to do, has taken some of the grittiness out of everything in Las Vegas. Handcrafted tubes of gas have been replaced with huge walls of video screens. More efficient, maybe, but not quite as poetic.
What about video walls? What's your feeling on where do you stand on video walls?
Video wall, that's 21st century technology.
It seems like they strive to be so literal with video walls with actual pictures and actual faces, but the signs are a little bit, give you a little bit spark of imagination.
The video wall is realism. Realism at its height. These signs, they're creative, they're poetry.
There is a kind of sexiness, a kind of lurid beauty to a neon sign that you just don't find in a Jumbotron video wall or LEDs. You can hear and feel the pulse of electricity as it surges through the gas. The feeling is palpable. It is the promise that under these undulating lights, something is about to happen. Maybe good, maybe bad, but something.
The Stardust sign.
Well, the Stardust was built in the 50s when we were doing atomic testing out of the Nevada test site. Mm-hmm. And so atomic testing was a tourist attraction. I mean, people literally came to Vegas in order to go up to the mountains, climb the hills, and watch the bombs go off. No one really thought about the radioactivity or it being a problem.
Yeah, there is that little drawback.
And so they created this incredible, if you want, I call it atomic lettering. Mm-hmm. And it's a font, again, created specifically for the Stardust Hotel. This is all that's left of it. The property's been torn down.
Walking through the city as the desert sky changes from day to night, I can see that there is still plenty of old neon to be seen in Las Vegas. But for how long?
Do you think that neon is in danger of disappearing, neon signs?
It is, I think, because LED is cheaper. The cost of the electricity for LED is significantly less. And the neon craftsmen, I think it's a skill and a trade that's kind of going away a little bit. Mm-hmm. I think there will always be neon, but in terms of signs of this magnitude, mm-hmm. maybe not, because LED is cheaper to do.
The writer John Updike, he once called Fenway a lyric little bandbox of a ballpark. And we're here right now in the Red Sox dugout. They have an incredible view. You can see 37,475 seats all staring back at them. And they can see when they slam one off the green monster. Speaking of going big, our own Dan Neal, he likes to go big. And he's right now at the Beijing Auto Show looking at some of the hottest cars on the global market. All I need now are some sunflower seeds.
China is a nation of 1.3 billion people. And here they are at the Beijing International Auto Show. Hi, I'm Daniel with the Wall Street Journal, and we are going to take a walk through this amazing show, which reflects the shifting center of balance in the global car industry. For example, a number of very important global premieres, including the Lamborghini SUV concept, the Urus, the new Mercedes-Benz CLA, the Jag XJ Ultimate, and a whole host of other cars that we're going to see in just a minute. Let's take a walk. And here it is, the star of the show. This is the world premiere of the Lamborghini Urus concept SUV. About 4 years away from production, if VW Group approves it. Of course, they certainly will. They haven't decided on a powertrain. There are a lot of things that must go on before this car is a reality, but the exciting part is that they've taken the styling vocabulary of their low, sleek, amazing sports cars, and they've converted, I think, fairly successfully into an SUV morphology. And it's beautiful, it is desirable. I think it will frustrate a lot of people who wanted to say, see, you can't make a Lamborghini SUV. Clearly, you can. And by the way, the color, Chinese red. Wow, I am really glad I didn't wear my gold lamé dress. Tell me, this car, the CLA, there's an evolution in styling language going on with Mercedes-Benz brand. Tell me how that evolution is taking shape.
Entirely new design philosophy, the CLA, a four-door coupe, which is very striking, sporty, and expressive in style. So we want to be very progressive here, very forward-thinking cars.
Let's talk inside baseball. It's often said that styling is free. In other words, that it costs as much to design a bad-looking car as a good-looking car. Is that true?
Yeah, that is definitely true. Apart from the interior, where it's like a certain intellectual level, and then above that, it's like input, how much money in terms of material and stuff you put in there, you know?
This is the most powerful V12 engine in production. This car is also amazingly efficient, 360 grams per kilometer. For Americans, that may be hard to parse, but let's just say that's an awful lot of fuel efficiency for a car that goes 0 to 60 in 3 seconds, 200 miles an hour, and has 740 horsepower. Now, what's also interesting about the F12 Berlinetta is it is a slight preview of things to come, because this V12 engine will appear in the Enzo successor with a hybrid KERS system. The nominal horsepower figures for that car are over 900 horsepower. So that ought to be fun. And you have brought a spectacular car. What is this?
This is the XJ Ultimate, and it is the Ultimate XJ.
That makes sense.
It's full of luxury. It's indulgence.
And why did you decide to debut it in China?
Most of our customers will probably be in China.
Is that right?
Absolutely. I think probably 50% of customers will be in China, because Chinese people like this kind of car. They like to be driven. They like the space. They like the luxury. They like to sit in the back. Probably more here than anywhere else in the world.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why it's here today.
Now, I noticed that the back of the car is a little busier than it used to be. Tell me what's going on there.
I had a design that presumed if you put the cat in the back on its own in this piece of pure canvas, it would work. What we're discovering is people don't actually know it's a Jaguar. Not everybody. And also, particularly in the Chinese market, people like to show off what they actually have in this car. So we also have the Ultimate badge. We also have the engine size. That's something specific to China, and possibly actually America as well.
Finally, a foreign word in Beijing I can pronounce. Très formidable. This is the Citroën DS9, and it's a concept car, reflects the company's new styling language. More important, it's debuting in Beijing, which reflects really the shifting center of gravity for European car makers. The growth is in China, and so Citroën really needs the help. They really need the sales, and China would be the place to increase those sales with a rather spectacular new design language. So what we have here is a 1927 Phantom 1. In 1928, the Phantom was redesigned as the Phantom 2. This one is a Martin and King bodywork. It is a open top. The important thing here is that this is the sort of car that establishes the breed, the brand, the tradition, the heritage of Rolls-Royce. And in many ways, that's what people are buying when they buy the new cars, because in many ways, modern cars are very similar, and it's very hard to distinguish. So oftentimes, what you're buying is only the poetry of the brand. And the poetry of the brand begins with cars like this. It is the year of the dragon in China, and Aston Martin has decided to honor that with three special editions of their cars, DBS, DBS Volante, and Advantage V8. This car has the gold dragons embroidered in the headrest, and it has a deep Chinese red upholstery and very market-specific colors. The danger is that it comes off as a little, the word kitsch has come up. But I think you'd have to agree that these cars are very, very handsome. And if you're bombing down the road in China, I think people would get out of your way. So that's it from the Beijing International Auto Show. For the Wall Street Journal, I'm Dan Neal, saying xie and dai cheng.
This is pretty cool. I'm sitting here at the keyboard where they play the organ strains that you hear during the games here at Fenway Park. And speaking of music, Terrence Blanchard, the composer, he has scored music for filmmaker Spike Lee, but now he's taking it to Broadway. Our own Jim Fusilli, our pop and rock critic, he sat down recently with him to talk about it.
Hey, for the Wall Street Journal, I'm Jim Fusilli. Our guest today is Terrence Blanchard, jazz icon, film score composer. No jazz artist has ever composed as many film scores as Terrence. He's doing the music for a Broadway production of Streetcar Named Desire. Terrence, welcome.
All right, thank you. Thanks for having me.
We're talking about some damaged people, some brutal people.
Right.
Some things that are never said but are shown quite clearly. Are you emphasizing story? Are you emphasizing character? Are you creating mood? What's your challenge?
It's more about creating a sense of the city and trying to create a mood. There's some things that I want the music to do in terms of creating the social nature of what New Orleans is all about. You know, when you listen to New Orleans music, the music itself has a very social approach to its performance. Everybody's playing, but it all makes sense. And when you look at this play, you know, it's really a beautiful ensemble piece. You know, you see Stanley with all of his guys playing poker, you see Blanche and her sister, they're always involved in these very communal things throughout the play. But the one thing that struck me was about all of the characters, in a weird way, there's an endearing nature about all of them, even Stanley. You know, because let's face it, Blakey always used to say, we're always trying to find out what our real truth is anyway in life. And that's what I get from these characters. So there's one particular theme that reoccurs. You know, I've been calling it kind of like the love theme. It's for Stella and Stanley. And that's probably one of the more specific character-driven themes. And then there's another one for Blanche as she has her flashbacks. There's a little piano thing that'll play for that. But other than that, the music is really trying to set the table, so to speak.
This strikes me as a rather recent phenomenon to have non-musical plays scored with the kind of cues that enrich the audience understanding. Is it a recent phenomenon?
Well, I'm not a big historian of the theater, but in talking to Emily Mann, you know, that was one of the things she talked about. You know, New Orleans, the French Quarter itself has a beautiful existence in that it's very much like living in New York. You know, people who are not from New York, they can't understand how you guys love the sound of the trains and the cars going by. You know, it's that constant rhythm of sound that you get used to, and it becomes endearing to you, it becomes your safety blanket. Well, in New Orleans, in the French Quarter, we have the same thing, but it's all music-driven, mostly. And then there's a cacophony of sounds of just people gathering and talking on the streets. So in this play, you will always hear, not always, but for the most part, you will hear things in the background. You'll hear music. There are two clubs. You'll hear music coming from one club on the right, and you'll hear music coming from one club on the left. So it's all designed to kind of just make sure that people understand that this is a busy area. This is a lively area that people are living in. So in that way, it's probably a little different than most plays.
More than 3.4 million people come to Fenway each year, but today it is just me. Now, no matter who you root for, it's hard not to respect this ballpark's history. So on behalf of all of the off-duty team, happy birthday to Fenway. Here's to the next 100.